Environmental Science of the Climate Institute. It is really an honor to welcome and to present such a distinguished panel of key working group leaders of the IPCC assessment report to discuss the issue of climate change, the science behind it, and the policy implications. I cannot thank more the organization of this panel. Thanks to the Geneva Environmental Network, to the IPCC itself, to you for making this event possible, which is indeed of not only great interest from a scholarly perspective, but it is of particular importance now that the world is moving towards perhaps the most serious negotiations in a decade on the next climate treaty. I would also like to thank my friend Jacqueline Potter to make this event possible for the Climate Institute and to emphasize the kind of the missions of the Climate Institute and the Center for International Environmental Studies is to work to provide bridges between scholarship and international policy. And the IPCC itself epitomizes this connection. The connection between science and international policymaking, and I must say the very difficult connection between science and international policymaking sometimes. The IPCC, as an organization, or as an enterprise rather, it's a local urban organization. It exists as long as modern climate change cooperation has existed. But I must say that when the IPCC assessment came out, I was really impressed in the sense that to me, this report compared to the other reports, including the Nobel Prize winning work of the IPCC, has moved the discussion and the agenda a step forward in the sense that it has taken a very clear scientific position on the reality of climate change and the implications for key sectors, such as agriculture, such as water, that are essential to human life. We used to know the IPCC mostly for the mass projections, the various scenarios, A1, B, B2, C, C3, there's no C's. But there are these scenarios that project certain trajectories and estimates of dramatic societal implications for different economic, social, energy, and so on trajectories. In the last report, in addition to this, forward-looking scientific work that is presented in the report, we have a set of clear statements and a set of certain projects of the reality of change, of the history of important changes in the climatic system and their implications for various sectors of society. I'm not going to be making any more general statements about the IPCC, because you have some of the key leading authors of that report in this panel. What, as a political scientist, I would like perhaps to place on the agenda is a scientific question about the role of this report. And today we will have the honor to have a discussion about the synthesis report that came in 2014 and it is presented for the first time in Geneva. And it is extremely important report because typically policymakers think of that report as opposed to the several volumes of the actual IPCC findings. So, in addition to the great scientific work that is presented in this report, perhaps we would also have an opportunity to push the science a little bit and to ask what is the likely role of these findings for the upcoming negotiations of the public policy? How have these findings affected already some of the positions of premises of these states in forming through arousal? Is there any possibility whereby the IPCC and its findings could present certain focal points around which new sectoral negotiations could go on? Or would the IPCC prefer to retain its role as a neutral scientific body that stays in the shadows of the facts in some Mediterranean fashion? Or advise the powers to be, or reinforce the indirect of the powers to be. With this rather political than scientific question, I would like to welcome very warmly our panelists and thank you once again for this opportunity, not only for the Graduate Institute and our students, but also for Geneva, to discuss the real issues of science and how they pertain to policy on the basis of the work of this excellent.
Thank you, first of all, for the introduction and for the expressive friends and gentlemen. My name is Anderson, I'm the regional director of UNEP here in Geneva. So I would like to introduce the first of all, thank you very much because it is useful for us to have here today for the event the event that's organized within the framework of the Geneva Environment Network. Both the Graduate Institute and the IPCC Singapore are institutions which are members of this network. And contribute early to the global environment governance agenda here today. 6 months after the Paris climate change conference, as the governments are now getting combined for the clear negotiations, we gathered here together as members of the NACO to hear from the IPCC best chairs and co-chairs about the scientific evidence of climate change. The IPCC assessment report, which was released last year, comprises three working group reports and the synthesis report, providing a clear view of the current state of scientific knowledge relevant to climate change. The Geneva Environment Network Secretariat has the pleasure to organize with the IPCC Secretariat presentations for all the working group reports in Geneva and the International Environment Paris in 2014. The synthesis report, which will be presented today, restores and integrates the findings of the three working group contributions to the many systems, written by over 800 scientists from 80 countries and assessing over 5,000 scientific papers. The IPCC's fifth assistant first policymakers lets the scientific community know about the scientific evidence of climate change, its impacts, and future risks. And actions for adaptation and mitigation. this providing movements that it is starting to find the same agreement in various subjects. It is my pleasure, therefore, to introduce to you today the main scientists, which are part of the hero who asked to present in detail the outcomes of the session. I will start by Professor Benson Green, one of the IPCC vice chairs elected in 2008. Professor Green was at the Korean University Graduate School of Energy and Environment and FOC. His research encompasses inquiries of climate change, energy, and sustainable development. He's also a member of the board of directors of the Korean Academy of Environmental Sciences. He was the co-chair of the IPCC Working Group 3 for Second Assessment Report, which provided a scientific basis for the UNFCCC's Professor was also elected as IPCC Vice Chair in 2008 after both the voting in sports in 1995. He teaches climate energy and environmental sciences at the University of Athletic Cleveland and co-directs the master program in science and management of the environment. He chairs the Energy and Climate Working Group of the Graduate Federal Council for Sustainability. In 2009, he was elected a member of the Belgian Royal Academy. He has participated to a number of United Nations conferences on climate change, a scientific advisor, and was instrumental in creating in 2002 the UN World Program on Climate Communication. Professor Sakana is the co-chair of the IPCC Working Group 3. Since May 2013, he works as a special assistant for the Soil Center here in Geneva. We have the pleasure to have him on the panel at the last event of the Geneva Environment Network for the next last month on climate and recent work at Taiwan. Before being based in Geneva, Professor Sakana was the coordinator of the African Climate Policy Center based in the United Nations Economic Council. Sakana was previously the executive secretary of the Sahara and Sahara Observatory from June 2004 to May 2010. A citizen of Mali, he focuses on the energy, environment, and sustainable development, nexus, and he has broad experience in Africa and policy development. Throughout his career, Professor Sakana has served in various advisory capacities to African governments. He has published several books and articles on the issues of energy, environment, and development for the focus on Africa. Dr. Scott Walker has been the head of the IPCC Working Group 1 Technical Support Unit since January 2014, where he previously served as the science director. Dr. Scott has held research positions at the University of California, Los Angeles, the University of Bern, and at ETH. His research focuses on the predatory and future carbon cycle and regional global systems. Dr. Spectator was a contributing author of the IPCC's first and fourth assessment report. The IPCC Working Group 1, Assessment Report 5, released a drafted policy on the standard of policymakers and coordinated the lead author of the technical staff. He was authored and co-authored for more than 40 peer-reviewed scientific papers. Over 60% of the public. Finally, I'd like to introduce my colleague from the UN system, Carlos Martin Manella, who is the officer in charge of the Secretary of Warfare at the CC, and who will be chairing our panel and moderating the event after the presentation. Before I give the floor to Carlos, I would also like to mention that the presentations which will be made today will be available as usual on the Geneva Environment Network website, where you will also find information about the events for the celebration of the World Environment Day, which I think we are celebrating on the end of this week. With that said, I'll pass the floor to the two panelists. I think what are you doing about that? This is looking like the fact that you're saying that. What are you doing about the process? And the first thing is that you think about the process of being such a person. You realize that you're the first step. The middle goes from the middle of the place from the slip of the point to the point of the place. The point of the place is that the point of the place is that the point of the place is that the point the choice of this policy action, so at least I can push back the circuit to this depending on the frequency of the networks and the function. And adaptation that is completely lost as a vaccine, and they can very compared to my social process. And that there is also adaptation that is so much responding to interaction. And all of these adaptation programs that continue to work to side advantage. To side advantage objective and risk perceptions. And therefore, for successful adaptation programs, they become the need to recognize that the interventions for the surface interventions and the adaptation limits I mentioned before, and that the molecules is solid, the to the combination of adaptation and those forces of sensor reduction and scarcities are coming from the first in the office. The increasing reductions, incremental reductions in the mass gases, of course, is a process of sensor. So therefore, the policies are to limit the minimum between the carbon budget and the budget we face in the biggest in the budget we are using on our surfaces in the
physical science aspects of this assessment, but this assessment for you, just to give you a quick introduction on what we think in terms of what the physical science could take to do that. I think we've mentioned before, we created the series of inputs, what we want is the man in the back, with the man's cover from the Arctic, was published as the first book of all news in 2013 in September, and has started into Census report, and was also provided the basis for the climate change assessment for the other two working groups. So, in terms of the census report, roughly 14 of the 250 that we were to do one of the stuff contributed to the writing. We have 14 messages of the Romans that we have been able, that has been able to establish that the human influence of the climate system is the reason of that, that it is affecting the climate. So that's a statement of fact. Also, we know that there have been changes in the climate, that these changes in climate have impacted the natural and the human systems. What we learned together with what we need to do, we're able to establish a key finding for what I think from the 50% of climate is, that we need to continue to bring those gas emissions to create CO2 and force for the warming. The first key finding that I'm sure that you will talk more about is that this reaching a certain target and working between what we want to do is a small number of scenarios with very complex models, whereas working between has looked at a huge number of scenarios with a more simplified climate model. And so, together, we were able to say that there are actually pathways that would apply to limit the warming to 2 degrees. Mentioned already by Thomas O'Leary, so we have a lot of different climate needs and changes that we have to get back to. I would like to dive into the working in one contribution to the change of climate. Working in one contribution really deals with observations of climate change, so what has happened in the past, what do we know, why this has happened, why this has changed, and the third part is what do we project into the future, assuming different pathways of each development and population. So this is the first graph, it shows you the global mean surface temperature, those averages, and you can see from left to right that temperature is increasing to the global averages, is actually increasing over the last 50 years. And it's the last 3 decades which are warmer than any preceding decade before the increases actually started. I think that those of you together with other observations from other parts of the climate system is that warming of the climate system is quite difficult. That's a repetition of the statement that was made back in the warming of the course assessment report, but it was so crucial for many people not to be misinterpreted that if we don't say it again, it might have changed the conclusion. It has not changed. The warming is quite difficult. It's not just atmospheric warming, it's also melting the glass, it's warming of the ocean, and it's changes in climate. And to summarize that, I present you one figure which is a physical view of the climate system. It shows you the energy content change since 1970 up to 2010. And we see that there are different colors. The different colors present the different parts of the energy of the climate system that have taken up energy over these 40 years. And there is one color that really benefits, and that's the blue color. The blue is the ocean, the light blue, upper ocean, the dark blue, and that blue, the deep ocean, the dark blue, the deep ocean. And ice and land and atmosphere are also. And if you look at this figure, you notice this little red color at the bottom of this, the atmospheric warming. So the atmospheric warming is really small. The current baseline degrees warming that we've observed in the past in the region of the atmosphere are minuscule compared to how much energy has been taken up by the ocean over the Pacific. So to understand climate change and whether the climate change continues on the better, that's so we need to look at the entire energy budget. But this was the first time in 85 that what we want to actually close this energy budget and come up with the Pavilion Circuit is, of course, a consistent picture of where the heat is. Also, warming dominates the increase of the energy stored in the climate system. Something not to forget, small changes in the ocean can have major implications on the atmospheric warming. What drives these changes? So that's the point of the understanding. We know from measurements of ice cores, but also from data of atmospheric measurements in just one year, for that green and greenhouse gases, CO2, methane, and NOx. There are increases over time, that start to increase with the start of the Anthropocene, the world industrial, the started, and they all continue to increase. Even methane, where we had a meteor 4, there was a small plateau in the interesting component is those emissions are higher because they were not there before in human history. And then, if you look at the slides in Paris, you see that the last 40 years we have seen the same amount of emissions as we've seen between 1970 and 2005. So, within 40 years, we have emitted 50% of this population. So, it's really showing the fast increase in populations. One of the most important climate systems core, and these recent anthropogenic emissions of greenhouse gases are the rising history of the Earth. Now, let's move on to projections for the future. As we showed you before, there are different pathways how we could get the future. We don't know how the future, which climate we can get. So, what we want to use is scenarios developed by working with three for our science community. And we focused on four scenarios to sort of represent the concentration pathways. So there are targets, first of all, not really important, but the important part is that it's a blue scenario, which includes a significant mitigation component. And there's the red scenario, which is more or less a business as people scientific. So you see that for both scenarios, that there's a intermediate scenario, temperature increase over time. So even under drastic mitigation approaches, we also see from that picture that the uncertainties associated with climate projections are quite substantial. What we try to do in this first one of these uncertainties, we do not mix the scenario uncertainty with the physical climate system uncertainty. So that's what we need to show the combined fact. So for each of these critical scenarios, we need to look at the uncertainty range that is based on the multimodal surface analysis of the climate. The question that was asked about was, what does that mean after a 1.5 degree target about 2100, for example? And it turns out that none of the higher scenarios is able to meet the 1.5 target. It's only the lowest distance scenario that with a likely trends will limit the temperature change to below the 1.5 degree. Also, it's not a global temperature, it's a global important piece. Distribution of the world, but see from this projection for the final scenario for the red one that all regions of the world will warm in the future. There's no region where it was extremely compared to there. And the highest warming is in the Arctic and overland where people live. So, further warming will increase the likelihood of severe progressive and irreversible impacts for people and for ecosystems. Looking at the sea level, another important point in terms of impacts, you can see that the historical reconstruction and measurements and then the future projections of the global warming and sea level has continued to increase over the last decade. So, from the start in the mid-19th century, and it will increase in the future. Sea level is even more slowly respond to climate change. Because the ocean reacts very slowly, we will see much more sea level in the future, even when we could meet temperature stabilization. 1970, over the past century, projected for the mean of the red scenario, right across 50-60 centimeters. But again, higher values are not excluded because that's what the mean of that uncertainty correct. So, in summary, climate change will amplify system risks to the extent of factors in order to create new risks. I let me go to one key component of the working on one assessment and also the working on three assessment. This is the concept of carbon budget. And the point here is really that we cannot just look at emissions last year, last decade, the last 50 years, but what actually affects the climate or drives the climate change is the total cumulative carbon over the last 250 years. So in this case, we have estimates up to 750, and all this leads to the global warming that we see today. So does it matter where you meet? Where you meet? It's the total amount that has been made. So what we want to try to put this into perspective and find that per 1,000 billion tons of carbon, the warming is 2.5 degrees Celsius. That's based on projections, the models is based on heat. So if the total amount of carbon gas for climate change is basically a future target because of climate change and temperature, this means that we have to limit our carbon budget to a specific amount. Our larger demand just depends on where we set the temperature cap. So 2 degrees will have a different budget, 3 degrees, 4 degrees, 5 degrees. And this is the nice point about this carbon budget concept because it can directly link the target with how much you can emit and not how you don't have to wait until you see how much you have to find, etc. So we have started from the working group 1 report, the budget for 2 degrees. And please allow me to use this figure that I have not put in just a few pieces here. This is about 790 billion tons of carbon for the budget that we estimate for 2 degrees. If you go beyond, it will exceed 2 degrees of 2021. CO2 emissions are from 2014, so updated from what is published in 2005, but we have to stop in 2007. It's now roughly 545 of these 790 billion tons of carbon have already been emitted. Which are responsible for the climate change that we see today and what is already committed to in the future. So we have a annual emissions of 245 billion tons of carbon. It's exactly the time chart that was on show before, except for the updated CO2 emission number. With annual emissions about 10 billion tons of carbon, you can calculate yourself how many years you still have to reach this use of the income. We think climate change will have quite substantial and sustained reductions in greenhouse gas emissions. And further with adaptation, this can limit climate change. So, let me conclude. It's really a matter of choice. Which scenario to follow? This is not a given which scenario to follow. It's a matter of choices politically, socially, technologically, whether you want to be in a 2 degree world or in a 4.5 degree world. And the one can only provide the basis to serve to the source of the technical system. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. I think there's been some great presentations for what I've heard of these great work that my sister is doing. And there is a lot of $1 million of the start of the second level even in the future, which is for the purpose of saving some sales content for the future. And some people could say, so what? What do you mean? It's like, what would it be like to give them some money? So what? So now that our people are less, it's pretty sure that we've got to run the best part and be the same as any other thing. So now that we're not these engagements in the collection and the society and the ecosystem for the chemical processing. There are going to be numbers for those who have the water and not for those who are just now, and there is something more important than that. Thank you. Thank you, guys. Thanks for having me, everybody. So, it's a pleasure to be here and speak to the distinguished audience. I want to speak about impacts on adaptation, especially from the central national part of the just a reminder, a couple of reminders of the context between the questions the IPCC is trying to understand and the strategies to report is what is happening with the history of that, so I think the risks are covered up, and we will talk more about the second and the third question, the third question for the discussion. The purpose of this study was certainly supported to you, or not already. Whenever I take a look to the first and the second and sixth and the third story of STEM, and where the next one is suggested from Oregon, and in the first speech, but there, if you want to summarize the 5,000 pages of the the treatment of the IPCC report, that this is an attempt to extract the key messages. The problem is actually an optimistic message, if you stand back a little bit, where it realizes it's not the sustainable development, but the more opportunities to integrate and to submit these, most of the first week of This is for a particular area. What elements of your understanding in a certain domain focus? This is not for a particular system, but you will have domains in that particular system. And I see So it doesn't stand up to study. That's what they are, but they're not what they're showing here.
With a 2-degree temperature to the 1.5-degree and as you can see, particularly for the term, the first two factors will oppress the allowing us somewhere between 1.5 and 2, approximately, the answer that is being into the right, that the world is slow, that the of the world is slow, and doesn't exist to the planet. Of course, it can be
the first
satisfy the famine as found in practice in the nature.
And then, when I first read what the background and sort of working
currently in the book, we can suffer an additional mitigation figure. I'm not a part of the next level mitigation, or I have to mitigate a lot of application for my method, and we are comparing this to my plan. And the third trust is a threat on sustainable development, it will undermine all the ground on sustainable development. And there's a separate implementation on now on relevant tools suitable to government structures and users' capacity to extract. And just to bring climate change and equity, as which I think also highlighted by the previous speaker, is a few problems discussed because of relative to current and past situation of greenhouse gas emissions. Because also the capacity of the countries, because also of the variable challenges and sacrifices in different regions and countries, but also equitable balance showing how we use the potential for cost of climate action and different sustainable development. And those are both missing the dialogue and just wanted to go to your attention within the 2 minutes of time budget. And thank you for that.
Thank you. Thank you.
think it's probably significant to see extremity to kids. I think the majority of them saying that this is all that all the knowledge of natural ability is concerned in that as much as it is. So, yes, this has to be a sort of contrast. The interesting question is whether these events are the more frequent or not the complete. And this is exactly the idea that this is the communicate. And we're not in the position to say
the other is to keep everything